Hi, everybody. On this episode of iTalk Movies, we're talking to the writer and director of the film The Edge of 17, Kelly Fremon Craig. Let's do it.
Welcome to Popcorn Talk, featuring movie discussion, news, and interviews. Popcorn Talk, we talk movies. And now, here's Popcorn Talk's iTalk Movies.
You're such a dickhead.
What an enjoyable song. I've never heard this before until I saw The Edge of 17. I'm excited to talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. Hi, everybody. Welcome to iTalk Movies. This is the show where we get a chance to get up close and personal with the creators behind many of the great films and TV shows that you watch there at the in your homes or in the theaters. I'm your host, Frank Moran. You can follow me on Twitter at HappyGoJackie. And my guest today is the writer and director, and I guess the creator. We can just go all-around creator of the film The Edge of 17. It's a great teen comedy drama.
Comedy.
Yeah, something like that. Here she is, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Kelly Fremon Craig.
Look at that. Thank you so much for having me.
Well, my goodness, the pleasure's all mine. Yes. So, all right, before we dive into everything, this song, the Dickhead song, as we talked about just briefly before, I had never heard it before.
I know.
And it was I was like, wow, that's a very unusual song.
Yeah, and I'd never heard it before either. And actually, it wasn't originally part of the movie, and it was actually the thing that saved a scene that was probably like the hardest scene in post to put together, was that swimming pool scene. And I had no out. There was originally the out of that scene was he would get up and he would turn on you would press a button and then like big fountains would go off and splash her. But it was so hard to actually pull that off logistically that when the fountains went off, it was like a so it's like climactic and terrible, and so it was like, oh god. And so I was like, all right, let's just shoot one where he's turning on music. But I didn't know at that point what it would be or how we would, you know, have we what he'd play or anything. And then later in post, it was just nothing was quite right. And then I was like, he's got to be able to get back at her somehow. And so I literally Googled "You're a Dickhead" song, like not knowing there's no way on earth that would exist, but you're desperate when you're in the edit. You're just like, I need something. And it popped up, and then I listened to it and it was so funny. And we cut it into the scene, and then it suddenly the scene worked. It had an ending.
I love those random Google searches when you just like throw in a word or a phrase and you're like, I did not even know that was a thing. I just threw it out there.
You can Google anything. I mean, that's what's amazing. It's really almost anything. And it's actually like, it's comforting when you do and it starts to like autofill stuff that you're like, oh. You know, that you're like, oh, I'm not so alone.
Yeah.
Like, you know, someone else thought to Google this crazy thing.
And because I felt like in that scene, it was just such a, because I feel like, it, and I don't know if you felt about it, and that's why you're having such an issue with it. It's like tonally with Irwin's response to that, his kind of letdown from Nadine, just kind of that serious, like, nope, I was
so,
just kidding.
It's so delicate. Exactly.
Yes.
It was so delicate. And also just like, you know, wanting to keep her likable, wanting to have her kind of get some comeuppance, you know, in that scene, wanting him to still like maintain his manhood, even though she's just done this kind of shitty thing to him, wanting to be able to go out on a laugh. Like, I mean, there's so many things that had to work for that scene to work, you know, and it was a tightrope the whole way through. I mean, the whole movie honestly felt like that. In so many cases, we were on a tightrope, and then there were so many places we could fall off, and you know, yeah. So,
well, we'll talk about that in just a little bit, but I wanted to backtrack a little bit and just find a little bit more about you, as well as letting our viewers learn a little bit more about you as well. So you said your family's from Orange County originally,
yep.
So that's where I was born and raised,
mm-hmm.
down there.
Yep, yeah, La Habra, Fullerton area. Yeah, I grew up there. Went to school in South Orange County and UC Irvine. So and then after that, like moved up to LA afterwards.
Now,
took that whole hour drive up to LA. It's like everybody in the world comes from like, you know, deep in, you know, some small town in Indiana and like comes out to LA, and I'm like, I got in my car and drove up the 405.
I first moved out here, they always made such a thing like Orange County, you're going behind the orange curtain. Was
yes,
that really
that's right.
A thing?
Oh, yeah. Oh, totally. Yeah. We were always, we constantly heard about the orange curtain. Yeah. And it honestly does feel like when you go into Orange County, it feels like you're just entering, it just feels more like the rest of the country. You know what I mean? Whereas LA is such its own, it's got just so much its own weird vibe. You know, it's just its own distinct thing. So.
Because I'm from the Midwest, and when I first moved out here, I stayed with some friends down in Laguna Hills. So there it felt very similar to where I was from, like in terms of, you know, just like the cul-de-sacs and the rolling neighborhoods and stuff like that. And that felt very similar. Mm-hmm. But then commuting all the way up here to LA, you're like, you could just see it changing as you're moving up. And you're like, ugh, by the end of it, you're like wanting to pull your hair out because of the traffic and stuff.
I know. Exactly. Yeah. You get deeper into LA and it's just like, traffic and all, and like the roads are torn apart and like the, I don't know where our taxes go. Like it's, everything's just graffiti everywhere. And I know.
So was filmmaking something you always were interested in, or is there some point in your life where all of a sudden that light kind of switched for you and you're like, yep, this is what I want to pursue?
You know, it's interesting because ever since I was a kid, since I was about 12 years old, I was making little music videos, but I never, and I loved it. I mean, that was like my thing that I would do. I would like cast my friends as different, you know, as different parts and make little movies and shows and stuff like that. But I never thought of it as like an actual career direction. You know what I mean? I mean, the idea of like, oh, you could do that as a career just never occurred to me. It was just this thing that was so fun to me. You know, it was just this thing that you do with your friends on a weekend. And then in college, I did an internship up at a production company up here and started to read scripts. And at the time I was sort of like, I shifted into writing and like just loved writing characters. And I found that reading scripts, it was just, I loved the medium. I loved the idea of all these sort of all these different imaginary people talking and being able to come up with them and make them say whatever you want, you know? And at first I really just thought like I just was going to be a screenwriter. And then I think you spend enough time just writing that you realize you can never, you can't, it's very hard to ever see what's in your head realized if you don't get to go direct it. So
I can understand when you're passing it on to someone else and then you get their vision of what you've written as well.
I mean, when they say like, you know, for film, the director is king, it's absolutely right. It's the dead truth. So,
So when you were directing these music videos as a kid, were you just taking popular songs at the time and say like, all right, I'm just gonna do my own music video to this song?
Oh yeah, exactly. Music videos were so formative to me. Like they were, I mean, it was also, you know, it was like the early 90s and it was like Aerosmith videos and like Smashing Pumpkins. And it was, you would spend your whole summer, like in a lot of ways, like in front of the TV, and MTV would be on and it'd just be like, that was the time when it would all be music videos. And there was just something about like the fusion of music and, you know, and film that I was just into. I love the idea of these little stories that were told, you know. It was, you know, by the end of the you know, 3-4 minute song, you had a little story. So I loved that. And I also, there's so much music in this film that it was, music is just a big deal to me. So,
Because I certainly, for teenagers, I feel like, music plays such an important part of the formative years. And some people still embrace that through adulthood and others kind of like fade away. And now today maybe embrace more podcasts or things like that. But I still feel like teenagers though, music plays such a part.
That's the thing. You know, it's interesting. Like, I remember at that age, there's always music on. There's always music on in in the background. Whatever you're doing, you have it on, you know? And it's also like, it's such a, what you like, who you like to listen to, what type of music is so, has such a big bearing on your identity, I think, or your sense of self, you know?
And certainly those are the ones that are so burned into your memory that anytime you hear those from when on, you boom, lapse back to that moment. You remember everything about that moment.
It is so amazing that still, I think it's because I always talk about this age being like, so interesting because the highs are so high and the lows are so low. So I think you're really like, you're so alive. Everything is just at like max capacity. And I think there's something about that it's like whatever is in the popular culture at that time that you're into, shows and music and blah, 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 and whatever. It's like, it goes in and it's like, it's there forever. It's somehow more emotional than anything else later.
Yeah, and it's also, I feel like certainly the beginning part's influenced by what your parents listen to as well. that? Because those are your first kind of curators of music. What they're listening to in the car, so driving you around, or what they might be listening at home when they're getting together for like a party or something. And that's like
Linda Ronstadt still. My mom would vacuum and listen to Linda Ronstadt, and I was like, still it gets me. I was like six and listening to it, and
my dad was an old school guy, so it was like Buddy Holly was always playing, and so like even now it's like I always grab it towards, I'll listen to a good Buddy Holly song. Why not?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So just one more question about the music videos. Mm-hmm. Going back, so you're watching these videos on MTV. Are you trying to recreate what you've seen, or you wanted to tell a different story based on that song?
It depended. Like, there were some that I was obsessed with. There was a John Mellencamp video of Wild Night that I was obsessed with one summer. It was just so good. It was just like this like beautiful girl who goes and like she's a cab driver and like I don't know, John Mellencamp gets in the back of her cab and I don't even know what happens, but for some reason I love that. I still love that song and I loved the video. So that I recreated with like my 12-year-old best friend as like the sexy model cab driver. Some of them it was just about trying to recapture it, and other ones just shooting whatever, you know, using the locations I had and just trying to kind of be inspired based on, you know.
That's going to be such a great learning ground for somebody that wanted to, you know, is interested in writing and then ultimately directing, interpreting something else and putting your own spin on it and creating your own kind of vision for something. Must have been a really cool experience.
Yeah, I mean, and honestly, just fun. Like, I mean, really, that's why it's like it never occurred to me the idea of like, oh, I could make a career out of this. It was too much fun for that. Like, it was like, it was just playing, you know? So.
When was the last time you ever watched one of those?
Oh, God.
Do you still have them accessible at all?
So now, like, sometimes on YouTube and stuff, but it was, and sometimes I'll go back and watch some of the ones that were really formative for me, like some Nirvana ones, like Teen Spirit was a big one, and Black Hole Sun, Soundgarden, that whole video was so weird and cool, and some I'll go and revisit just because they're so nostalgic for me.
And what about your takes, your videos that you shot? Will you go back and watch those, or no, are those lost to the annals of time?
You know what? They're all, because I shot them on this like big dinosaur camera, you know, with the VHS tapes, and yeah, I mean, I haven't in years because I don't even know where I'd find a VHS player. But we got to like convert them and do. I really actually that makes me want to go do that. I think I got to go back to my mom's house.
I have a VHS player and a converter. So.
Oh yes. Oh,
all right, James in the booth, man. Set this up. All right.
Okay.
Kelly, you're taken care of.
Great. I'm excited.
That would have to be such a trip down memory lane just to see that.
Oh my God! Yeah. Yeah.
I had a science teacher in sixth grade who decided, you know, we're not really going to study science. We're just going to make movies. And so,
Are you kidding me?
Which was so great. That was so cool.
That's the coolest thing ever.
And to go back, I remember like in high school going back and just seeing, he goes, oh, I still show this to my class. And just watching, even though it'd been like 3 or 4 years, but going back and seeing like, holy cow, what were we thinking?
Yeah.
It was such a fun experience.
But at that age, it's so, I don't know. I remember you'd be so proud of what you put together.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm sure you look back now and you're like, what the hell was this? Yeah.
Yeah. So you decided you wanted to embrace screenwriting. So this is like a career. What, in terms of where you're just kind of making your name as a screenwriter, coming up with sample scripts, things like that, what did you want? What was your kind of avenue to kind of make your way in as a screenwriter?
I really, you know, I moved up to LA and then I started to just like temp, you know, places, and then like landed like a little receptionist job, and then, you know, was somebody's assistant or whatever. And then I was just writing at night and just trying to like get a first script. I knew that if I could just get a spec script done, that maybe I could like beg enough people to read it, that maybe it would, I don't know, open a door somewhere. And so then I got that first thing done, and then that opened the door to getting my first agent, and then it was like, and then that sold, and then that, you know, and then I got other jobs off of that. And so it was kind of, yeah, it sort of snowballed from there.
So for you, just in a day-to-day life, even now, do you have a kind of a regimen and routine in terms of writing for you? Do you try to do it every day?
You know, it's weird. My life has shifted so much in the last couple of years because I have a 3-year-old now. So it's like I used to be able to get up and kind of have like a normal 9 to 6 day or whatever. But now, like, if I go lock myself in the other room, he's like knocking every second, you know? So it's just, you have a 4-year-old. Yes. So yeah. So it's just, so I'm trying to kind of shift things around. Also, I've been directing, like, it's just been a different, you know, I was out of town for a long time. And then, you know, just being on like the publicity tour, that's been keeping me busy. So I haven't really, it's really only in like in the last week have I been like, all right, I've got it. Like I'm going to look for office space because I can't work in my house anymore because yes. of my 3-year-old. Because I just want to play with him. It's too hard when he knocks and he's like, mommy, what are you doing in there? So we'll see. I don't know. It's going to be a whole different deal now.
Yeah, absolutely. Could you see yourself, I know you're saying as a screenwriter, you ultimately wanted to lead in directing because you wanted to kind of carry your material and your vision all the way through. Could mm-hmm. you see yourself directing somebody else's screenplay? Would you want to be in that situation?
You know, it's a cool time right now and that I'm getting sent just a lot of different stuff to, you know, to direct, a lot of different scripts and, it's interesting, you know. I'm keeping an open mind and still trying to, you know, look for stuff that I think I could interpret well. But for the most part, everything I read, I'm like, no, I just can't. I can't. So I think ultimately I'm gonna go back and write something. I think I just have to. I don't know. I think, you know, I'm like, I'm a writer first and foremost. Like no matter if I ever get to, you know, direct again, if I will write until the day I die. And no matter if anybody pays me, like, I will write until the last day. So it's just in me, you know what I mean? So, I think I'll definitely, I'll be back at my laptop.
Would it be, because I wonder if you're just having your director cap on, you're getting mm-hmm. sent all these scripts, do you find yourself always putting yourself in the writer's shoes? Does that make it kind of tough? Like, I don't want to do this and this, but is that what they wanted? I don't know. And now I'm kind of superseding their vision for this material?
You know, I mean, mostly right now as I'm reading scripts, I'm just kind of going, can I feel this? You know what I mean? I mean, for me, that's so much as I'm writing, it's like I have to have almost like a physiological reaction to it. I have to feel where I'm like, ooh, I know that feeling. I know that person, you know? And if I don't have that, I feel like I'm getting ADD in my, like, as I get older, I'm getting it or something because I'm sort of like, I don't have any patience. I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm done with this one. All right, let's look at the next one. So, but it's like, I'm waiting for that thing that's, I don't know, that thing where you're just like, ooh, I can care about this. I can sink my teeth into it. So
do you feel your barometer is pretty good that if within the first, you know, 15 pages or so, if it's not grabbing you, you get a good sense like it's probably not going to grab me entirely, or you read it all the way through and go like, oh wow, at the end I can understand now, all right, I could see,
you know, that. I wish I had the kind of patience that I would actually read to the end, but I just can't. I start to get mad too, like, I don't know if you've ever read something where you're like, this is, and then I'm just mad. I'm having pretend conversations with the writer. I'm like, why did you do this? You know?
Yeah, because I understand you'd want to start making choices. Like, do this instead.
It's bad for my mental health, so I just have to put it away. Yeah. So, or sometimes you'll read something and you're just like, ooh, you're just stunned by the writing, and it's wonderful, and you're so happy to be in this person's presence and being like, you know, taken by the hand through a story. So I mean, and those are just the best. It's the greatest feeling in the world when you crack open a script and that's the feeling. You know what I mean? So I'm still looking for that one, but in the meantime, probably gonna write my own thing.
Yeah, and I can understand, like, maybe even reading a script that you like, wow, that was just really well done, but I can't see myself directing it. But it's still a great story.
Yeah. No. Absolutely. I think I have, you know, I think tonally, I'm, you know, what the tone of The Edge of 17 is probably where I'll always live, somewhere in there. You know what I mean? I don't know that I would go more, I probably won't go more broadly comedic, and I probably wouldn't do like a straight drama, you know? I think I'm somewhere in there, and I don't know that I'm capable of not doing that. You know?
Because, yeah, I don't know, what I enjoyed about The Edge of 17, and it's just that I feel like life is never just all completely comedic or all completely dramatic. It's just such a blend of both.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
there can be just something even blackly comic in the saddest moments, and then something really kind of heartrending in even the most funniest moments. Well,
yeah, I totally agree. And also, that's like, to me, the way to, for me, the way into something like painful and complicated and interesting, I like finding it through comedy. You know what I mean? I like touching on something that's dark and a little scary to address, but then finding the absurdity in it. You know? I don't know. That's exciting to me. That challenge is exciting to me.
Now, as a writer, who were some of your inspirations? John Hughes, of course, this has kind of a feel of that, but who else is kind of inspires you as a screenwriter?
Well, James L. Brooks, our producer. I mean, that was crazy to be able to, I mean, because he really was, his films were the films that like made me go, ooh, I really want to be a filmmaker. And his films, I would walk out of and say, that's a perfect movie. It's a perfect movie. How did he do that? You know? absolutely him. Richard Linklater, I love the Before series. I love mm-hmm. that. I love Alexander Payne, everything he does. It feels like a gift on my doorstep. I'm so happy every time he's made a film. Judd Apatow's stuff is, you know, it always has a, I think the thing that's so great about it is it's funny, but it's also, there's always just something deeply true at the center of it. Mm-hmm. You know, there's heart and yeah.
So you mentioned James L. Brooks. Mm-hmm. So now just in terms of just seeing how this whole process worked, you had the idea for the film and then you get the opportunity to have a meeting with James L. Brooks and you pitch this to him. Mm-hmm. How were you able to set this meeting up?
Well, I had written this script as a spec, so my reps sent it to his company, and it was just sort of like a Hail Mary pass. We'd never ever thought in a million years he'd actually read it, but I was such a huge fan that we were like, all right, let's just take our shot and see. And it ended up that it was lucky that he happened to be at a place where he was, you know, I guess like right between projects, or had his life was settling down enough to actually sit down and read it, and then we sat down and started.
Because I was reading an interview where he was saying that he wasn't really in a good place in his head when you guys had that meeting, and then mm-hmm. you left and you got a couple steps out of there, and you mm-hmm. turned around and you said, "I will work harder than anybody else at this," and he pulled you back in, and then you guys did the project together.
Yeah.
So just in that moment when he's like, "Yeah, okay, forget it. Thanks for your time. I appreciate it. See you later, Kelly." What made you decide, like, two steps in, like, I can't leave this room without just giving everything I have to get this project on its feet?
Well, the thing about any of these meetings is you don't actually know the person has written you off, you know?
Okay.
They're very polite about it, especially Jim, you know what I mean? You don't know that. So I thought the meeting was going great. I was like, all right, you know? And I think, you know, in terms of working hard, like I don't know. I'm definitely one of those people that really probably puts in like an obsessive, crazy amount of like workaholic hours. I think anything like worth doing requires that of you, requires just all of you and you to, you know, be there until the wee hours and have kind of fight for perfection as much as you can, you know what I mean? I don't know. So I guess there's something, I don't know. I almost don't even remember saying it. I'm glad I did, you know? But, and it's definitely, you know, something I believe and something that's true, but.
So you have the spec script written for this, and then I understand in the interviews that I read that one of the greatest insights that James L. Brooks gave to you is like, do research mm-hmm. on this. Really dig in, talk to teenagers, find out about them and really influence this.
Yeah.
How did the spec script change once you did all this research?
Completely, completely. It was, the first draft was a completely, absolutely different tone. It was just, everything was a lot more heightened. It was more broadly comedic. And then when I sat down and did these interviews, I just found that it was, you know, it's high school's funny, this age is funny, but it's also dark and, you know, and painful and a lot of different things. It was just a lot of different shades. And that to me was much more interesting than poking fun at it or being, you know, just playing on the irony of it the whole time, you know? So I sort of really like fell in love with the people and the stories that I was hearing, and then just shifted directions completely and wanted to somehow capture that. And the other thing that was so amazing to me is when I would sit down with all these teenagers, I asked every single one of them what movies really accurately reflect your life. And every single one of them, probably 50 or 60 in all, said there aren't any. I was like, man.
Wow.
Yeah, I found that like just staggering and that sad, is,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, for every American Pie or something like that, it's like, no, that's not really
right.
How
yes,
life is.
Yeah. So now it's like the best compliment that I hear is, you know, is when people say, "Oh my God, that's it. That's you got it. That's right. I so relate." You know, that's the coolest. That's the coolest of all, because that was really the mission at the beginning.
During the course of the research and then working on the script, were there character arcs that were altered or characters that were kind of added or subtracted through the course of that research that you thought like, oh yeah, I want to change this and this and this?
Literally every single, not a single character, line, anything from the first script is in the second script, is in that post-research script. Everything was thrown out. I mean, it completely, the only thing that remained was the idea of like a girl whose best friend starts to date her brother, but that was it. That's
really
it. Like that sort of vague concept, that was it. But yeah, like Mr. Bruner didn't exist in the first draft. The mom, the dad, there, I mean, it was just, yeah, nobody, it was a completely different world. So I
certainly feel like as we talk about the idea of somebody dating your brother, especially mm-hmm. your best friend,
yeah.
But I feel like the sibling dynamics, that is always such an interesting thing to explore, because sometimes you could be estranged from your sibling and then get closer later in life. Sometimes you could be really thick as thieves and then grow apart, or sometimes you're just never really on the same page throughout your whole life.
So in
terms of like deciding what kind of story you wanted to tell with these siblings, did you kind of explore a couple of different dynamics, or was this always like, I want to kind of see, have them kind of estranged at first and kind of come together at some point at the end?
I knew I wanted, you know, the story for me was always about her believing that everybody else's life was better than hers, like, you know, and that, and how lonely you can feel when you tell yourself that story. And I feel like that's like a lot of us do that when you're going through like a shitty time. You can really feel like, I'm the only person on the planet that feels this bad. You know, everybody else is happy. They're doing great. They're posting great pictures on Facebook, you know? And I liked the idea that her brother was like the greatest manifestation of that sort of lie she's telling herself, you know? And for part of their coming together, to be about realizing that we've all got pain, you know, we've all got complicated stuff we deal with and carry around, and some of us mask it better or you know, deal with it differently.
And certainly a lot different than I guess when we were growing up, in terms of social media, that really just has such an impact, because you're right, you're putting your best face forward on social media. So if to only go by that, you're thinking everybody else is like fantastic and they're hanging out, they're doing these cool things, and me, I'm just, you know life is crapping on me constantly, and so what's going on?
Yes, exactly. I really do believe that has made everybody like just a little lonelier, you know, because it's really easy to look and like, especially when you're that age and you don't know that that's a lie, you know what I mean? You don't know that that's actually just an edited version of somebody's life, that obviously, you know, obviously it's a lot more complicated than whatever like pretty filtered picture you're seeing, you know? Yeah.
The, certainly at the beginning of the film, not really spoiling much about that, but the father, you decide to, the father passes away during the early part of the film. What made you decide, like, I would like to take this character out of the picture and just see how this family kind of carries on without this key central role in its family unit?
I really, it was interesting to me, the idea of what happens to a family when the strong person, the person that's the glue, that's really the reason the family's functioning, is suddenly taken out of the picture. You know, what happens then? It's just interesting how much dynamics shift when something like that happens. So it's just, to me, it's just interesting to explore, and also just the idea that he was the one person that got Nadine, that really saw her and was able to manage her, and you know, and and how when he passed away, all of that sort of shifted onto her relationship with her best friend. Now the best friend's the only person in the world. And how scary it would then feel that to lose that person, you know, and have nobody. So.
And it is interesting just also just like with Mother, and just how she kind of just focuses everything onto Darian and says, all right, you are the man of the house, and mm-hmm. I will just kind of, whether willingly or just unknowingly, just push these things onto you because there's no father here to kind of really oversee everything else.
Yeah, and I think something like to Kira Sedgwick's credit, she had such compassion for Mona, for the character. She just really she understood that that she wasn't, that she was trying her best. You know what I mean? That she wasn't consciously trying to like make her son shoulder all this stuff. You know, and doesn't even really, you know, realize it until the son says, you know, in the end, well, why do you always call me then, you know? And then she's like, oh my God, you're right, you know? But I think she played her so beautifully in that you got that this is a person who may be failing, but she's trying and failing, you know what I mean? As a parent, you know, she's trying to do her best, but, you know, missing the mark, which I think is a lot of us. You know, I feel that way a lot of days.
Oh, absolutely. I can believe you're completely right. Like, yep, well, I was a failure today. All right. I'll just see what I can do tomorrow.
Yeah.
During the course of all this research and you're talking to these teens, were there the elements that you have in the story and the kind of beats, were they drawn from those interviews or just some kind of ideas and tones and arcs of these characters? But things like with the father taken out of the picture early, were those just kind of ideas of yours that you kind of combined with all the research that you did to kind of form this whole screenplay?
Yeah. It was really more just a general sense that just a feeling I was getting from everybody that I was talking to. And there was just, you know, no matter who I talked to, there was just kind of a loneliness underneath, you know, and it was trying to capture that. And then there was one specific girl who talked about losing her dad when she was 13. And it really, and her story really, really struck me. And she, you know, and she had a mom who was now trying to date and who was very insecure about now trying to date. And so she was sort of stuck in this position of having to mother her mother. And that was probably the one that I actually used the most from, but in general, it was more a general sense.
And I can understand for Mona, that's certainly not what she thought her life was going to be. She thought she was going to be married with Nadine's father for the rest of her life, and everything was going to be great, so to speak. And then all of a sudden, the person that you were thinking you're going to spend the rest of your life with is all of a sudden taken out of the picture. That's, you know, as much as you're supposed to be the adult in that situation, mm-hmm. I can understand you're thrown off your axis, so to speak, as well.
Right, exactly, yeah. It's interesting to me also see, you know, how different people deal with grief. You know what I mean? I mean, the people who kind of swallow it, like Darian does, and, you know, push it down and just, you know, try to keep the course, stay on the course. And then, and then Mona, who's it's all, you know, they're a victim of it. You know what I mean? And they can't get out from under being a victim of that, mm-hmm. you know? And Nadine sort of acting up and trying to pretend she doesn't give a shit, but when she really does, you know? I mean, there's so many different ways that you deal with, I think, something tough. So.
So, as you say, you're writing the original spec script. Mr. Bruner didn't exist.
Yeah.
But then you start writing this, and then you get the fortunate happenstance of being able to cast Woody Harrelson in
mm-hmm.
this.
Yeah.
In terms of that, and especially, I guess, with all the characters, how much of that was just on the page, or how much is that once these actors get a hold of these characters as well, start adding their two cents in, do they kind of get to the performances that we see ultimately on screen?
You know, for the most part, the movie is the script, but there are certain things that Woody improvised that, like, for instance, it was his idea to put the pencil sharpener I love that. And he did that in rehearsal and the whole crew broke up. It was so funny. And a couple, you know, and tossed off a couple lines here and there. And that was a fun thing, especially watching like Woody and Haley together. They would just, like, you could tell they really liked each other. They just liked acting together because there was just, it was like they had a cool sparring partner. And so it was fun to just, like, once we got the script, to say, okay, whatever you guys want, like, try something, have fun. Let's just, you know,
and go for it. From the interview that I was reading, that you were saying once you had her from the beginning of the film, she comes in and says, all right, you know, I'm going to kill myself. Just want to let you know. As an adult, want to let you know. Yeah. And then coming up, like, how would somebody respond to that? And then the idea you have, like, all right, you know what? I also have a suicide note.
Right. Yes, yeah.
And to read that.
Yes.
Once you had that idea, I mean, I imagine just the rest of the character just kind of locked in place.
Yes, that was what was so weird. Yeah, that was such a weird experience as a writer. It's like sometimes you have those experiences where the scene kind of lands on your lap, you know, and that was one of those. And sometimes you know what you need the scene to do, and you're molding, and you know. But this was just, it kind of fell. And then at the end of it, I was like, oh, I know who she is and I know who he is. Now, where are they going to go? You know? So it's like magic when that happens. It's the best feeling and it's rare, yeah. You know?
And what I loved about that relationship is there, I guess, you know, in life, there's just, whether it be student, teacher, or coworkers, friends, that there are those people in your life that you can be antagonistic towards.
Mm-hmm.
But you just know that there's this underlying of caring, even though if it's not really demonstrated or said, but you just know that you just keep hanging out with each other because you just know you have that kind of connection.
Yes.
And I felt like that was so well realized between the two of them. Mm.
And, you know, and so much of that I do think is just in them being tremendous actors, because you get that, like, he's so funny and he's so dry with her, and he's, you know, and he manages to somehow both convey that she's getting on his nerves and that he loves her in some way, you know, and that he's, you know, he's kind of happy she's there, and he's kind of, you know, yeah. So it's a credit to their great acting, I think.
And what I liked about that is certainly Nadine, you know, makes her assumptions about his life. And I do like the line, like, well, you're the only person that's ever underestimated what I make, which is great. Thank you. But it's always interesting with teachers growing up. You assume so much about them just from the way that they act in a class or your interactions with them in or after class.
Yeah.
And not knowing they could be completely different outside of school, at home, and you have no idea.
And I think that's so true of people in general. I think, like, you know, you see one, you know, however we are in our lives, like, you see one facet of a person. I see you here sitting in class, and I have, like, and so I fill in all these other blanks, but, you know, it's
mine,
like,
are more, way less underwhelming. Yeah, whatever you're assuming is way better than what's really going on.
But it's so interesting to find that, like, you know, people are a lot of different things, and a lot of times stuff you just have no idea about, you know? That's always fascinating to me. I love that. I love that people are that complicated.
Yeah. But I also like the fact that in this day and age, you could also call up your teacher. I'm also remember back in school, like, boy, if I was in trouble, would I be able to contact the teacher?
Yeah.
I like that you're, all right, through, you know, social media or means, you could actually get in touch with the teacher if you needed to be able to pick you up if you're having a tough time.
Yeah.
I was like, I would have, like, Mr. Sarducci would never have picked me up. Like, I would have no idea how to get in touch with him. So was it the idea, like, you know what, I want to have this, when she does come to his house, were you weighing the ideas, like, what his home life was going to be, or did you always have the idea at the beginning, like, yeah, I want him to be married and have a young kid?
I knew that I wanted whatever was behind that door to be a surprise, and I thought the biggest surprise would actually be that it's warm and human and loving, and that he's not this kind of, you know, he's not this kind of pathetic bachelor or whatever that she's painted him as, that she thinks she has him pegged. She thinks she has everybody pegged. You know, she thinks she knows who her brother is and knows who he is. And the truth is, in the end, she doesn't know who anybody is, because she's been so wrapped up in her own, you know, in her own issues. And I liked the idea of I don't know, making her realize that people are more than you think.
And because I mean, that also makes me think of also Nadine and Krista's relationship as well. Just certainly she starts dating her brother, but always interesting at that age, it becomes so much more black and white. It's like, you know, you're either my friend or his girlfriend. You can't be both.
Right, yes.
There's just no way. And at that point, it's like ultimatums are so easily thrown out at that age. And you're like, whoa, it doesn't have to be that way. It could be everything still.
Yeah. Well, I think also at that age, like, your friends are a really big part of your identity. You know what I mean? I mean, I think even more than who you're dating or anything, like, it's who you hang out with is, it says a lot about who you are. And when you lose that person, it's, I think maybe even more of a blow than losing like a some romantic interest, because on some level, like the romantic interest, you know that's going to end eventually, but a friendship, you sort of believe they're going to be there for mm-hmm. you forever, you know.
Speaking of that, romantic relationships, certainly Nadine has the object of her affection, mm-hmm. and yet we've also got Erwin mm-hmm. as well, mm-hmm. and it was just so telling, like, because there are people that you just us as viewers watching, mm-hmm. like, that's the right guy for her. They have such a natural, just easygoing friendship and chemistry. Yes, mm-hmm. they would be great as a couple. Mm-hmm. But even within it, and I'm, you know, I've certainly been guilty of that in my life, where that's mm-hmm. like the person that may be best for you, you still have eyes on somebody else that you're like, all right, this person's great, but you know what? As great as you are, I still can't, I'm obsessed with this other person. So mm-hmm. I could completely relate to Nadine, where
yes,
it's like,
yeah.
how do you walk that fine line of, I want to be a friend with you, and I know there's some sort of attraction between us, but mm-hmm. I'm also really obsessed with this other guy, and he's so hot, and he works yeah. at Bentland, and I want to get with him, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, no, totally. And I think also there's something about, like, particularly at that age, like, mystery is a big thing, you know, like a person that you don't know a lot about, so you get to like color in all the other blanks, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You get to fill them in with whatever you want, you know, whatever fantasy you have. And and I feel like that's, I remember that feeling a lot at that age. There were the people that you would just see just across the room and be like, oh my god, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, but they're, you know, they're a person like anybody else, but from across the room,
oh yeah, everything
seems
great,
be anybody. Yeah, yeah. So
I really enjoyed Erwin, though.
He's amazing. The kid who played him is just Hayden Zito is just, he's phenomenal. I'm so lucky I found him and that he exists. Like, I honestly, I say that all the time, because I can't believe, I mean, he's better than I ever could have imagined, you know. It's like I wrote that part and wrote him as Korean American, and thought, oh man, we're gonna have, I don't know how long we're gonna be in casting for this, you know, trying to find this. And it turned out he was like one of the, I don't know, like third people that walked in the door. He was the first person we cast. He was so good too. It was like, we don't need to see anybody else. He's it.
No.
He's so good.
Just the
He's
awkwardness.
So funny.
Just the funny, nervous awkwardness was just so entertaining to watch and so relatable.
And he somehow makes awkwardness new, you know what I mean? Because we've seen it a lot, but somehow he makes it completely his own.
Yes.
And so adorable, and somehow, and also not, you know, it's interesting. One thing he said about his choice as an actor that I thought was so brilliant is he said that he actually never made the choice to be awkward. He was making the choice to be cool, trying too hard, and then that, you know, and then it came off as awkward. And I think that might be like the answer to why he's so great in it, because he's never trying to be bumbly where you see through it, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? He's actually trying to impress her.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Because I know you also said in interviews that it's like a lot of talking to the universal truths, but the uh-huh. specifics of how you tell this story are going to just make it pop with so many more people. So in terms of the specifics for you, what were some of the things that you really wanted to make sure, like, all right, I want to hit these key points in this film to really kind of make this film just pop for viewers?
You know, it was really important to me that the atmosphere in general felt like life, you know what I mean? And that's, I think that, like, that requires you to be kind of obsessive. I'm just gonna keep using
no,
the word
that's
obsessive.
Fine.
That's
right.
How I've been about this film. But I think I honestly think, like, filmmaking in a lot of ways requires you to be that. It requires you to care enormously about details, you know.
Well, you're giving up years of your life for this project. So if you don't care about it, how can you expect anybody watching it to?
Yeah, yeah, but I think also it's just like it's the way a room is, you know, the way a mess is laid out in a room is, you know, a lot of times a mess tells a story, and there's a way to do a mess that looks like a production designer did that, and there's a way to do a mess that feels like I see the story of this I see who this person is, you know what I mean? And it's
And I will throw out for an example for that, Nadine, that the bathroom and her room after yeah. she's about to go out on her date, and everything is just
yeah.
And I was like, I'm way too familiar with, you know, walking into either myself just through sheer laziness, destroying a room like that, and coming in like, what have I done?
Right. Yes. Yes. Yeah. 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 But I don't know. Just those little details. One of, you know, when I was doing the research, one of the things that I would ask the kids that I was interviewing is that I'd say, all right, go back to your room. Don't touch it. Don't touch a thing, and just snap a bunch of pictures for me and send them. And it was, and they were like, awesome. Because at first, when I would say, can you send me pictures of your room? They were like, oh, I got to clean it up, you know? And I was like, no. And then, and they were just, you know, it was really neat. It was really neat. You could really, you see a lot about a person when you see their space, you know what I mean? So that was like creating spaces and wardrobe and hair and all, like all those little things that tell a story about a person. Like that was, I loved that. And I think, you know, and it was nice to go a little crazy trying to get those details right, make them feel like life.
We've been talking about, of course, through the research that you did through the course of this interview. Did you go into that research with any sort of assumptions? And during the course of that, kind of those assumptions were changed? Or did you pretty much just go in and it's like, I'm just going to be open to whatever they say. I'm not bringing any sort of any assumptions into these.
You know, it was interesting to me how much hadn't changed. You know, I think my assumption was that I was there to find out what was different from my own high school experience, and that I was there to find out about how is Facebook, how are you dealing with that in your life or whatever, you know. But the truth was, it was all the same stuff that I had dealt with. So that was, in a way, really wonderfully eye-opening and permission-giving, because it allowed me to just go back to my own feelings at that age and write from that like ache, you know? And so, that was probably what was most interesting to find out about.
Yeah. Cause I guess, you know, certainly, I guess as you say, like the bells and whistles, may have changed through the course of the years in terms of like social media and stuff, but just the essential truths of being that old and having hormones and having life experiences, like, and everything's incredibly super exciting or super depressing. Those essential truths probably aren't going to change.
Those are just there. Yeah. And all the other, the bells and whistles, as you say, they're just sort of amplifying those things that have always been there and will always be there, you know? Yeah, it was in a way, it was nice to come away from that research and feel like there was sort of a kumbaya thing. I don't know. It was like, oh, we're all in it together. We're all just, you know, we've all survived this thing, and it's, you know, and in some ways I think like the feelings of that age, even though they're so heightened, but I don't know that they ever quite leave you. I mean, they're the same things you deal with all, you know, throughout life, but at that age they're life and death. Because you also don't know they're going to end. You know what I mean? At that age, you don't know that, like, life has an ebb and flow and this too shall pass and all that type of stuff.
You think it's forever.
So you can't talk to your... Yeah, yes. You can't talk yourself off the ledge as easily. You know? Yeah.
What I enjoyed about all the characters, though, is that you feel like I could watch any movie about any of those characters. But for this, we just happen to be our main...
That's a great compliment.
Yes.
Thank you.
That Nadine just happens to be our point of view character for this particular story. But I could see it be from Erwin's point of view, or it could be from Darian's, I could see it be from any of the characters.
Oh, thank you.
Which
that
I thought was
really
cool.
A great compliment. Thank you.
So for you, Nadine, you choose to have Nadine be the point of view character through this story. Mm-hmm. And you talked about tightropes at the very beginning, just in terms of, and I can imagine her character had to be the toughest one to work, because there's points where she's just incredibly unlikable, but we still have to root for her through the course of this film. How challenging was it to kind of make us still want to root for her, but still show both the great parts of her and the ugly parts of her?
The biggest challenge of the film, the number one challenge of the film. I mean, really, the goal was always to show her warts and all, you know, to really not pull any punches. But I always knew that would be a tightrope. I always knew that it would be tough. It would be tough on set. It would be tough in the edit, just in general. It was going to be the thing of the movie, and the thing we had to pull off to make it work, you know, because if you don't root for her, the movie's done. You can't, you can't stay on board for it. And part of what I was doing was on set, Haley and I would always talk about doing takes on a spectrum, you know, and we'd push it real hard where she'd be shitty, you know, she'd be an asshole, and then we'd pull it back and she'd do takes where it was just all vulnerability. It was all from that pain, and you could feel it, you know? And that was really so helpful in the editing room, because, you know, when you got in there, you could shape it, and you knew when you could push it a little farther and the audience would stay with her, And then when you really, you needed to pull back for a moment and let them feel like her heart and where it's coming from, you know? But I think having done it on a spectrum was a big, that was the only way we could have done it, mm-hmm. you know?
Because I feel like watching this film, now with the passage of time, and you're able to look back and you realize that it's not forever. And that, mm-hmm. as you said, they're the ebb and flow, that you can look back and say, oh, Nadine, just come on, get it together.
Right,
it's not that bad.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's one of those things where, as adults, you want to tell your kids that. But mm-hmm. I feel like those are the lessons that, as much as you want to tell you need to live it. And you need to mm-hmm. be a jerk. And you need mm-hmm. to be confused. And you need to be scared. And you need to be bold. And you have to do that yourself. No matter how much somebody else, as an adult, will tell you, it's going to pass.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go through those moments.
There's no way but through it. I really think, there's nothing anybody can tell you. And that was also like another important thing for me with Mr. Bruner. I really understood exactly what you're saying, that there's nothing anybody could tell you. So it was important to me that he never told her anything. Here's the secret to life. Here's what you need to learn to figure this out. But that he was just there. He was just there for her, you know, just a presence, and that's it, you know.
But I do like the scene where you set it up, where he's going to give her this profound.
Right. Yes.
It's like, there's something that needs to be said, so I'll just say it. Get out.
Yes. Exactly.
I like that. Very nice.
But and I do think that's the truth about it, that there's nothing you can really say. Yeah.
So doing this film, writing it, doing your research, directing it, editing it, getting it all together. For you, how has anything from your perspective, or is there anything that you kind of, I don't want to say like demons from your past that you exercise, or just, mm-hmm. you know, things that you're able to, just from your own experience, like, oh, I just had a chance to kind of, you know, look back on those things and maybe have a chance to kind of put them away, kind of address them. Was there anything going through the whole experience, did you come away changed, or just like, nope, it was just a great project and I enjoyed doing it?
One of the great things about making a film that you really care about is that you get lost in the work. You know, you really, like, when I was on set, I was so focused on serving the movie that you forget yourself, that you sort of lose self-consciousness, and it's wonderful in that you kind of enter this weird, like, zen state, almost, because you're just so focused on serving the film that you don't have time to be in the chatter of your own head, you know what I mean? And mm-hmm. that was really a wonderful experience, and it also showed me that whatever I work on, I've got to care about that deeply, because I think it requires that of you. I really do think the job requires you to completely check yourself at the door and just be the person that's shepherding this thing and its servant, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So Kelly, as we're wrapping up, certainly everybody go see Edge of 17. It's still playing in theaters, which is cool.
I don't know if it's still playing in theaters.
A couple areas. I remember like North Hollywood that are still playing in a couple theaters here.
Nice.
And there. So yes,
right.
Still yes. So yes. Look, Google it up. Mm-hmm. Find out if your town is still playing it. So go check it out. Do we have an idea of like any kind of VOD or DVD release?
End of January.
All
iTunes.
Right.
It's on iTunes.
Oh, yeah. All right. So make sure whether you check it, I had a chance to see it in the theater, eat your popcorn, or just sit at home and eat your popcorn. That's always good too.
Yes.
But Kelly, if they want to follow anything about The Edge of 17 or just continue on and follow you to see what projects you're working on next, mm-hmm. what's the best place to pop? Take two. I do that. What's the best place to follow you?
I'm on Twitter, K Fremon Craig. At K Fremon Craig, and I'm also on Instagram at Kelly Fremon Craig, and or you can follow the movie at Edge of 17. So
all right, certainly you're not going to see probably my glowing praise on any sort of poster. You know, Frank Moran says it's great, it's a must see, but it's a great film. I really enjoyed it. So thank you so much for coming in and doing this.
Great interview. Thank you so
much. Oh, my gosh. Tell your friends. No, just folks, I'm Frank Moran. This is going to do it for this episode of iTalk Movies there. But you can follow me on Twitter at HappyGoJackie. And we will see you next time for another edition of iTalk Movies here on Popcorn Talk. Have a great night, everybody.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.